naturally is gold. Mm-hmm. So you see Negros and yellow check. Nicol was still here, still coming together. About 8 million years later, Philippine forest is born, yet still connected with the Sulawesi and Tuborne, which allowed much of the latter species to arrive. 4 to 6 million years ago, this is what happened to the Philippines. It's already known as an archipelago and still allowed crossing for Cebu and allowing for those two species. Of course, the closest relatives are Borneo. It's amazing how you can actually relate geology without the movements of hornbills, guessing from the origins using historical biogeography and using from the genes. So it's amazing that you can actually use geology, bioinformatics, genetics, and molecular biology to understand how species move across the world. And of course, thanks to Robert Paul for lending his maps. So think of it that a lot of Asian hornbills actually speciated because of the instability of the islands. There's a lot of island formation still. And that's how a lot of species speciated. So going back to those arrangements, how many species do we actually have? In the Philippines, because there are polytypic species, meaning maraming subspecies, we still have to discern how many there is. So for those of you who don't think you're familiar with DuPont, well, DuPont had a biopic where he was portrayed by Steve Carell, and in love siya kay Channing Tatum. Mind that movie. Anyway, he's also an ornithologist, and he actually did a book called Philippine Birds. And Philippine Birds is one of our oldest field guides. So amazing. Does anybody have a field guide on birds with them? Ngayon mag-aalak siya eh. Yung DuPont kasi hardbound. Pag nalaglag nga yun sa paa mo, patay yung kukumuin sa bigat. Anyway, so at that time, there were only 5 species of hornbills in the Philippines until Kennedy split up a few. And now we have. So this is more like a representation of what William Oliver did for his monumental poster on hornbills of the Philippines. So there's 4 clades, about 15 taxa, roughly about 10 to 12 species. And it repeated today, amazing dwarf hornbills, one of which is found here. There's Samarensis in Basilanicus, Samar, Lake, and Bukod. Basilanicus from Basilan. By the way, we don't know what happened to it. If you're interested to study the Basilan hornbill, you're very much welcome. Dala na kayong ransom money. Tikaensis, unfortunately, Godot was able to go back to Tikau and try to search for the remainder of what we call Tikaensis, the Tikau terrific hornbill. I think we fear it's already extinct, but again, you're welcome to find it again. Manila Sub-Negra or Sub-Negra, an important picture, is from Pulido Island. We have Mrs. Dance here, who was also studying the terrific hornbill in Pulido. So this is that clay, amazing, a very large group. It used to be just one species. Weird, no? So without the proper classification methodology, you just say, oh, there are one species. So for many years, even up to the year 2000, it was one species. So now we've split it up to 6. And some of them, we are arguing, are 6 groups arranged around the archipelago. So we have Manila, Mindorensis, Manil, Samarensis, Aphinis, and Basilanicus. All sorts of species of the genus Penelopidas. Along that way, you have distinct, because of that reduced area of occupancy, now they're considered an endangered species. Again, we used a methodology using the BOU criteria and molecular divergence as a thesis. Although not all of them would pass. For example, with Samar native of all the subspecies, we matched it at the one from Mindanao, and the score was 7. Again, the threshold for phenotypic score is also 7. So, pasang awa. Diba? Ano bang grading system yun? From 1 to 5. Tresa amin ang pasang awa, 16. So yung mga dapat yung pasek. However, for molecular divergence, it was only two. Remember the threshold was four. So which do you use? Who do you believe? The geneticist or the morphologist?
Awayan.
We usually use both. But both, we have no problem. But yeah, we have to consider either of them. So here is the Luzontoridicum. That is the subspecies from Makiki from Bolillo. Actually, here they're called. Males are black and white for Pinodobides. This one has a pink face. Females have a blue face. And they're black.
I don't know if you can actually hear that. You can hear it?
No. Hindi kaya.
So it goes like tick, 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 tick. So that's why they're named Tarik. So the name is onomatopoeia based on what they call this. I think it's pretty hard if your parents would name you certain call. Ano ito nagpulis ko ng baby ko? Wah! Wah! So pangalan ko si Wap.
Onomatopoeia.
So going back, this is again Raptoramenus. We have two species, Waldenite and Leucocephalus from Mindanao. It's an amazing group. They all have this weird, colorful oil gland that they have in the back of the rump, and they have a very staccato call. If you hear them, they're also very similar to Pinodobides. Medyo staccato ang tunog. So this is their clade. There's four species there. And in the Philippines, they're distributed with some science.
In Mindanao.
So before, there used to be one species, Waldenite and the Mindanao. So we did the same thing, looked into the phenotypic form, Pasado at 10, and then the molecular divergence at 5. So both pass through the threshold. So yes, they are two distinct species. Unfortunately, because of the reduced area of occupancy, look at the conservation status, then you have to put them that factor. So, okay, this is the second, the third clade, Lantococeros. They're usually black and white. This is one from Palawan, the other one from Cebu. They're recent arrivals from the Sundaland. This is third clade here. They're very much related to black hornbills and white hornbills of Borneo. That is their distribution. Again, very recent arrivals. Palawan is still quite endemic. Cebu, Tawi-Tawi also quite. Unfortunately, there's only a few left in Cebu. Well, still in Cebu, they're mostly remaining in Tawi-Tawi.
So they're considered as critically endangered.
I haven't seen them myself. There's only a few people have photographs of it in the wild. So this is my favorite, the Kalaw. It's our largest hornbill, Oceanus clade. There are three subspecies. We now consider them as genetically divergent. However, the phenotypic score only allows us to split them into two. This is the kind of flagship species for our Kalaw.
Can you hear it? It's amazing. That's a big family group.
They actually are cooperative breeders. I mean, cooperative breeders. Parang ate kuya system. So the first born ate kuya will stay behind in the, with the parents and raise the next set of pouch. And they're very resonating calls in the forest. So here's the clade. They're very much related to the ones in Borneo. The hornbill. Another one, Vigil, is the health of the hornbill now. Critically endangered because that's where you get hawking or the hornbill ivory. That's the distribution. It's very similar to the distribution of the Philippine eagle. So we looked into species limits. We think that the Mindanao and the Samar should be separate. Has a score of 4, yet the molecular divergence is 8, twice the threshold. So it is genetically distinct. pedomorphologically in this stage. Between Bucetus megaflorans and Mimanensis, Pasado siya sa score at 9. And molecular divergence is also 8. So yes, they are separate species. So which one do you follow? Just morphology or both? Today, the weird biology students know that you are genetics or morphology. So, if you consider it, we need to reset once those conservation rights, once you change by splitting the group of formula 3, they become, not, nowadays, they still consider as near threatened, but splitting up would be considered their areas of occupancy, and then you would understand how much threat they are, especially on the three different island groups. So currently, there's 5 threatened species of hornbills around the world. 5 to 7 of those are from the Philippines. Roughly 60 to 75% of the endangered hornbills are from the Philippines. Even if we're not we're number one. It's a bit concerning because 2 of the most critically endangered hornbills in the world are endemic to the Philippines. So these are the 2. Walden's, which we do have, and the Sulu hornbill, considered to be 2 most important hornbills in the world. So yes, as the future of Negros Island, it's in your hands how the future of Walden's hornbill will be the next few decades. So it's not just those 2, these other 3 species are also considered to be endangered. Malawan hornbill, which is vulnerable, Nora hornbill, also vulnerable, and the Visayan hornbill, which is your other hornbill, only have 2, is also considered to be endangered. So 2 of your hornbills here are, again, some of the most important species in the world. So here, this was considered to be near threatened before. Once we split them up into 3 different species, they also become endangered. So that makes up 10. 10 out of the 12 in the Philippines are endangered. But again, it's something that is a challenge. So for you guys, these 2 species are most important. The Dulangan and the Turintik, only found in this region and nowhere else in the world. And with that, I thank you for your attention. So if you do have a chance to visit the museum, then there's a map to the museum, Google Earth map, so you can see where it is. And with that, thank you very much.